church and the assistant to the pastor for community engagement. In just a few moments, I'll be introducing our pastor, who will come and provide you with words of welcome. But first, we'd like to begin with a benediction. Would you pray with me? Dear sovereign, majestic God, we thank you for this evening that was written in the book of life ages ago. We thank you for the provision that has made it possible, and for these, your children, that have come so that they may be enlightened. Let us be ever mindful that we are your actors in this world, that we are called to dismantle systems of oppression. Where there is corruption, we must speak out, condemn it, and make demands for change. And we ought not stop until that change is made. Let us be ever mindful that while we need your love, grace, and mercy, that none of these are cheap, and that you have called us to purpose in this world. That like the prophet Isaiah, you have called each of us in our own way to preach good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and to release the prisoners from darkness. Forget not, God, lest we forget, the men, women, and children who are now and have been subject to various forms of incarceration here and throughout the world. And now, as we stand poised to elect the next president of the United States, pierce, God, the hearts of our two candidates, for the demand has not been sufficient upon them to share their views on caring for the poor or on fixing America's exceedingly broken penal system. For they too need to know in the depths of their souls that that which they do to the least of these, the hungry, the sick, and the imprisoned, we do unto you. So on this night, let the words that shall come forth from Professor Michelle Alexander break all spells of ignorance, hypocrisy, weakness, and fear that hinder us, this body, from making ours a more just, loving, peaceful, and sustainable world. Bless her, God, in all that she does. Keep her and her family from all harm, safe from all harm. Continue to allow her voice to be heard throughout the land, and give her, God, traveling mercies as she sets about the task of changing our world for the better. And the people of God said amen, 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 and amen. Amen. I now introduce the pastor of Olivet Institutional Baptist Church, the Reverend Dr. Jawanza Coven.
Good evening. Let's give ourselves a round of applause. As Reverend Leah Lewis has indicated, I am the Reverend Jawanza Coven, the pastor of the Olivet Institutional Baptist Church, one of the sponsoring organizations of tonight's event. I also want to acknowledge all of the sponsors of tonight's event, and on behalf of each of them, to welcome you. Cleveland UMADOP, Case Western Reserve University's Social Justice Institute, MSASS Black Student Association, and the Office of Inclusion, Diversity, and Equal Opportunity. We want to welcome you to an evening which is long overdue. There are several organizations and institutions which are represented here tonight, and we do want to take this opportunity just to acknowledge some of those that which we know are present here in our company. Certainly, Tri-C, Akron University, John Carroll, Brighton and Stratton, CMSD, many of our religious congregations, among them Greater Cleveland congregations, the ACLU, the NAACP, breaking the cycle facing our history, partnerships for youth community, Lutheran ministries, and neighborhood connections. Let's give all these organizations a round of applause. Our purpose here tonight is threefold. First, to bring some information. We are living in some treacherous times, both socioeconomically and certainly politically. And it's so important that we are informed. We are informed about the issues that affect us, particularly those whose skin have been kissed by nature's sun. And so as we begin mindful of the information that's going to be shared with us tonight by Dr. Alexander, we are ever mindful of the context in which we live, particularly in the state of Ohio. In the state of Ohio, one out of every five African Americans lives in poverty. In the state of Ohio, one out of every three African American families are struggling on some form of welfare. We are living in a context in which people are challenged, and we believe that, as Dr. Alexander has indicated in her book, that many of these issues related to poverty and economic injustice are related to our prison industrial complex. And so our goal is that it might bring forth some information that might be new, but also might rekindle those things which have been lost to our remembrance. We also want to bring forth inspiration, that we will be inspired by her courage, inspired by her tenacity to bring forth these issues to bear even in the present political climate. We are mindful that in inspiration, it is nothing without action. And so on the other side of being informed and inspired, that we might begin to act. And you will see on our program tonight that there will be a call to action. Ms. Jessica Horn and Mr. Dante Gibbs, the executive director of Cleveland UMADOP and the former president of MSASSCWRU, Black Student Association, will bring forth a call to action that will include, among other things, a community meeting. And there are several organizations here that you will discover are engaged in all sorts of ways and means and methods in order to begin to address many of the challenges which will be lifted up on tonight. I have the dual purpose of also serving as the co-chair of the Greater Cleveland Congregations, and we are not ever mindful that we are in a political year, an election year, and if you have not voted, you need to vote. In addition to that, there are many major efforts in our city to move people to the polls, to get people out to vote, and I want to acknowledge the presence of two Monique Smith and Kalila Worley of Greater Cleveland Congregations, who are leading our Get Out to Vote effort. Are they present on tonight? And so, and I want to encourage you, among the many opportunities that will avail themselves on this evening, if you are interested in joining a Get Out the Vote effort, mobilizing your community, your congregation, your neighborhood, your street, your block, please see them. They will be in the foyer immediately following this program for sign up and for further information. We are in for a delight. And now I want to turn it over again to our formal program.
Good evening. Good evening. I'm so glad to see you all. We knew we would have a crowd, and we're so glad that you're here. My name is Dr. Marilyn Sanders Mobley, and I have the honor of introducing both our moderator and our speaker for this special evening. Our moderator is Dr. Rhonda Williams. She is an associate professor of history, as well as the founding director of the Social Justice Institute at Case Western Reserve University, where she also initiated and directs the postdoctoral fellowship in African American studies. She serves on the President's Advisory Council on Minorities and on the Diversity Leadership Council. She is the author of the award-winning book, The Politics of Public Housing, Black Women's Struggles Against Urban Inequality, and co-editor of two volumes, Women, Transnationalism, and Human Rights, a special issue of the Radical History Review, and Teaching the American Civil Rights Movement, Freedom's Bittersweet Song. She is working on two book-length projects, Rethinking the Black Power Movement and the Dope Wars, Street-Level Hustling and the Culture of Drugs in Post-1940s Urban America. And she is co-editor of the new University of North Carolina Press book series, Justice, Power, and Politics. Dr. Williams is included in the 2009 edition of Who's Who in Black Cleveland and is a former Harvard University W.B. Du Bois Institute Fellow. She's a brilliant teacher and faculty leader, a fearless community activist, a social justice change agent, and a dear sister scholar and friend. Rhonda, could you just wave your hand so they can see where you are? I should say Dr. Rhonda. Our speaker tonight is Professor Michelle Alexander. A longtime civil rights advocate and litigator, she won the 2005 Soros Justice Fellowship the same year she joined the Ohio State University faculty. She holds a joint appointment with the Moritz Scholar, with the Moritz College of Law and the Kieran Institute for the Study of Race and Ethnicity. Prior to joining the Ohio State faculty, she was a member of the Stanford Law School faculty, where she served as director of the Civil Rights Clinic. Professor Alexander has significant experience in the field of civil rights advocacy and litigation. She has litigated civil rights cases in private practice, as well as engaged in innovative litigation and advocacy efforts in the nonprofit sector. For several years, Professor Alexander serves as the director of the Racial Justice Project for the ACLU of Northern California, which spearheaded a national campaign against racial profiling by law enforcement. While an associate at Saperstein, Goldstein, Demchak, and Baller, she specialized in plaintiff-side class action suits alleging race and gender discrimination. Professor Alexander is a graduate of Stanford Law School and Vanderbilt University. Following law school, she clerked for Justice Harry Blackmun on the United States Supreme Court and for Chief Justice Abner Mikva on the United States Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit. Michelle Alexander's The New Jim Crow, Incarceration in the Age of Colorblindness, has been on the New York Times bestseller list for 38 weeks and running. Her book has also been the subject of several weeks of book discussion right here in the Greater Cleveland community. The list of those of us who have been part of bringing her here, we've been engaged in book discussions, and I heard Pastor Colvin say that she was going to light a fire under us. She's already lit a fire under most of us, which is why we couldn't wait for her to be here tonight. We are most grateful for the ways in which this powerful book has been a catalyst for dialogue about the root causes of a problem that concerns and affects all of us. Please help me give a warm welcome to our guest speaker, Professor Michelle Alexander.
Thank you. Good evening. It feels so good to be here, surrounded by so many people committed to having a meaningful dialogue about this system of mass incarceration, a system that has decimated so many of our families, destroyed so many of our communities, and literally turned back the clock on racial progress in the United States. I am just delighted to see so many of you here tonight, here on faith, acting on faith that we collectively can rise to the challenge that this moment in history presents. A wise woman once told me that, quote, in life, there are acts of great faith and acts of great foolishness, and sometimes it's difficult to tell the difference between the two. And well, several years ago, when I first began writing my book, I believed that I was taking a great leap of faith. I was trusting that if people of faith and people of conscience had access to the history, data, and facts about the drug war and the myriad forms of legal discrimination against people released from prison, that they would have the same awakening that I finally did. They would begin to see the connections between the institutions of slavery and Jim Crow and mass incarceration, and they'd begin to see the necessity of bold, courageous action to dismantle this system with the fierce urgency of now. So I desperately clung to this belief that people of faith could and would rise to this challenge, The challenge presented by this paradoxical moment in our nation's history, a time when there are staggering numbers of black and brown men and women in prisons and jails, and yet we have our first black president of the United States. I hoped and I prayed literally down on my knees that if I could just finish the book, that a seed would be planted, one seed planted right next to the other seeds of hope and justice beginning to take root, and that in time people would begin to water these seeds and a vibrant, multiracial, multi-ethnic movement for racial and social justice would emerge again, a movement that would end not only mass incarceration, but this history and cycle of caste in America. Well, many people called the idea of my book project foolishness, including a few of my closest mentors and advisors. I was told that I was ruining my career, and that if I hoped to be taken seriously as a law professor and as an academic, I ought to stick to writing traditional law review articles and not marginalize myself as some kind of radical. And I must admit that after a while, I began to believe that maybe my dream was foolish. Not so much an act of faith, but more an act of foolishness. And I tried to quit writing the book. Writing it was so much more difficult than I had imagined, and I started to think that maybe it wasn't really worth the effort. But spirit was working in my life in ways that I didn't fully understand. Every time I told my husband that I was giving up, for real this time, seriously, honey, I'm giving up, quite by coincidence, a letter would show up in the mail from a prisoner or a family member of someone who's behind bars, a letter begging me, literally begging me to finish the book. I had given a few media interviews about my work in progress, and word had spread. I began receiving letters from people trapped within the system thanking me for embarking on this journey, for writing this book, and telling me I need to go ahead and tell the truth. One letter began in it said, I quote, "You're probably thinking about quitting, as I'm sure many people are telling you not to write this book, but do it anyway. Do it for those of us who no longer have a voice." And I now see that I would have been a fool not to finish. A movement to end mass incarceration is, in fact, emerging in the United States. And while my book may not have been the catalyst, it is becoming an important tool, one that would have not existed if I had not listened to spirit whispering in my ear. I can see now, with my own eyes looking out at you, that spirit is whispering in your ear too. And I believe that prayers are finally being answered. The prayers of so many people, so many families struggling to survive in this era of mass incarceration. An awakening has begun. My own awakening, though, didn't happen overnight. As I describe in the introduction to my book, there was a time when I strenuously resisted the very claims that I make in the book and rejected the cause that has now become the passion of my life. Back then, even as I was working as a civil rights lawyer and advocate, I resisted comparisons between mass incarceration and slavery or mass incarceration and Jim Crow. I believe that people who made those kinds of comparisons or those kinds of claims were exaggerating or engaging in distortions, hyperbole. In fact, there was a time when I thought that people who made those kinds of claims and those kinds of comparisons were actually doing more harm than good to efforts to reform our criminal justice system and achieve greater racial equality in the United States. But what a difference a decade makes. For after years of working as a civil rights lawyer, representing victims of racial profiling and police brutality, and investigating patterns of drug law enforcement in poor communities of color, and attempting to assist people who had been released from prison re-enter into a society that had never shown much use for them in the first place, I had a series of experiences that began what I now call my awakening. I began to awaken to a racial reality that is just so obvious to me now that what seems odd in retrospect is that I could have been blind to it for so long. As I stated in the introduction, what has changed since the collapse of Jim Crow has less to do with the basic structure of our society than the language we use to justify it. In the era of colorblindness, it is no longer socially permissible to use race explicitly as a justification for discrimination, exclusion, and social contempt. So we don't. Rather than rely on race, we use our criminal justice system to label people of color criminals and then engage in all the practices that we supposedly left behind. Today, it is perfectly legal to discriminate against criminals in nearly all the ways in which it was once legal to discriminate against African Americans. Once you're labeled a felon, the old forms of discrimination, employment discrimination, housing discrimination, denial of the right to vote, exclusion from jury service, suddenly legal. As a criminal, you have scarcely more rights and arguably less respect than a black man living in Alabama at the height of Jim Crow. We have not ended racial caste in America, we have merely redesigned it. Well, I've been doing a lot of traveling in recent months, meeting with advocates all over the country and engaging with communities who've had enough, with folks who are eager to wake up, get up, and take a stand. I've been meeting some extraordinary people, people who have been moved by their own faith, or their own conscience, or conviction, and are finding their voice and doing the hard work of truth-telling and organizing in their communities. People like Susan Burton. I met Susan a couple of years ago now, and she is what I call a stone catcher. So many people in our culture today are eager to throw stones. In the Bible, of course, there's the story of the woman who committed adultery. A group of men gathered around her, prepared to stone her to death for her sin, for her crime. And what did Jesus say? Let he who is without sin be the one to cast the first stone. And as each man considered his own sins, the stones dropped to the ground one by one. Well, today, we as a society love to throw stones. And Susan, she's someone who hasn't just dropped her stone. She has run into the fray to catch the stones that are thrown at others. Today, it's not enough simply to drop your own stone. We've got to be willing to catch the stones raining down on the most vulnerable. And we must be willing to stand up to the stone catchers and disarm them. Susan is doing precisely that. She knows what it feels like to be hit by stones. She herself cycled in and out of prison for more than 15 years due to a drug addiction. She succumbed to drug addiction after the Los Angeles Police Department, the LAPD, killed her 5-year-old son. An LAPD police cruiser was speeding down her street and ran over her 5-year-old boy. Now, if Susan had been wealthy, even if she had been middle, upper middle class and had a good health care plan, she would have qualified for lots of therapy. She would have had access to legal drugs that might have helped her cope with her severe depression and her grief. But things were different for Susan. She was impoverished, living in South LA. And in her grief and in her depression, she became addicted to crack cocaine. And for the next 15 years, she cycled in and out of prison, never offered drug treatment, only shown a prison cell. Cycled in and out of prison, and every time she was released, she was tossed out onto the street. No shelter, no place to go, unable to find work, forced to check that box on employment applications, asking, have you ever been convicted of a felony? Sure enough, she cycled right back in. Well, finally, by the grace of God, Susan got access to a private drug treatment facility and she was given a job. And when she became clean and was able to afford a roof over her own head, she decided that she was going to commit the rest of her life to ensuring that no other woman would have to go through what she went through. And she began by going down to Skid Row and meeting the prison bus as it released women onto the streets in LA. Women getting off the bus carrying nothing but a cardboard box, carrying their belongings. And she would say to these women, strangers to her, come home with me. You don't have to turn to the streets. You can sleep on my couch. You can sleep on my floor. I'll give you a safe place to stay. You don't have to turn to the streets tonight. Susan now runs 5 safe homes for women in Los Angeles. And not only, is she providing people with a place to sleep, she's helping them find work, giving job training, connecting people to jobs, helping them find permanent housing, helping women reunify with their families. She's helping people dodge the stones, helping them to get work, housing, feed themselves, reunite with their children. And when the stones start coming, when a CPS worker, social worker says to a woman, no, you've done so much time, you don't have a chance to get your child back. She says, no, I'm going to catch that stone. I'm going to court with you, and I'm going to stand with you, and I'm going to fight to get your child back. And on top of that, Susan is organizing formerly incarcerated people throughout California, organizing them to confront and challenge the stone throwers, organizing formerly incarcerated people on initiatives to ban the box on employment applications, organizing people to demand housing for people released from prison, organizing for the restoration of their basic civil and human rights, standing up saying, no, I am a human being too, and I deserve dignity and respect. When I meet people like Susan, I'm filled with hope. And I've been meeting a lot of them, young people, old people, people inside prisons, people in churches, courageous pastors who are willing to speak truth to power, people who are not just catching stones, but confronting the stone throwers, people who are willing to turn over the tables in the halls of power, say enough is enough. But I've also been forced to accept that most people of all colors are still asleep, sound asleep. Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. once said, quote, there is nothing more tragic than to sleep through a revolution. And he was talking at that time about a profound moral revolution that was underway, the struggle for the dignity and humanity of all humankind, the struggle to end what was then America's latest caste system, a system known as Jim Crow. And in the months before Dr. King's death, he told an audience the story of Rip Van Winkle, who famously fell asleep for 20 years. And when Rip began his extended nap, there was a sign posted on the wall of a nearby inn that had a picture of King George III emblazoned on it. And when Rip woke up 2 decades later, that sign had a picture of George Washington on it. And Dr. King told the audience that the most striking fact about the story was not that Rip had slept for 20 years, but that he had slept through a revolution. He said, quote, there are all too many people who, in some great period of social change, failed to achieve the new mental outlooks that the new situation demands. Well, I think his words are as relevant today as they were back then. Many of us, myself included, slept through a revolution, actually a counter-revolution. A counter-revolution that has blown back so much of the progress that was made in the movement that Dr. King gave his life for. This revolution has occurred with barely a whimper of protest, even as it has successfully relegated millions of people, poor people, overwhelmingly poor folks of color to a permanent second-class status, stripping them of the very civil and human rights supposedly won in the civil rights movement. While many of us have been asleep, a vast new system of racial and social control has emerged, a system of mass incarceration that would certainly have Dr. King turning in his grave. One day, I think we may look back and wonder how we could have possibly slept for so long. I thank God that some of us are finally waking up. One of the questions that I've been asked over and over again since the book has been released is, why? Why have the very folks who have been targeted for mass incarceration been so quiet? Why have black and brown people not raised up their voices, protested what has gone on? If this is so bad, if it's like a new Jim Crow, then why does it seem so well accepted, so easily tolerated by those whose ancestors have been there before? Well, I think the reality is that so many of us have been lulled to sleep. We've been lulled to sleep by the superficial appearance of great racial progress. And we've been lulled to sleep by the myths that have been told to us in the media, in the politicians, the myths that have been offered to rationalize this system of mass incarceration. Black folks in particular have been led to believe that we brought all this on ourselves. If only our kids would stay in school. If only our kids would stay away from the drugs. If only our people would just act right, then we'd be free. Then we'd be free. We brought this all on ourselves. These myths are so powerful, and we've internalized them and believed that this is all our fault. We're the guilty ones. Well, I want to talk for a few minutes about these myths. First, the myth that mass incarceration has been driven by crime and crime rates. It's not true. It's not true. During the past few decades, our prison population has quintupled. We've gone from a prison population of about 350,000 to now over 2 million. As a nation, we have the highest rate of incarceration in the world, dwarfing the rates of even highly repressive regimes like Russia, China, or Iran. But this cannot be explained simply by crime or crime rates, no. During those same decades that our prisons have exploded, crime rates have fluctuated. Gone up, gone down, gone back up again, gone down again. And today, as bad as crime rates are in many parts of the country, crime rates are at historical lows. But incarceration rates have consistently soared. Most criminologists and sociologists today will acknowledge that crime rates and incarceration rates have moved independently of one another. Incarceration rates, especially black incarceration rates, have soared regardless of whether crime was going up or going down in any given community or the nation as a whole. So what does explain this sudden explosion in incarceration, if not crime and crime rates? Well, the answer is the war on drugs and the Get Tough movement, the wave of punitiveness that washed over the United States. Drug convictions alone, just drug convictions, accounted for about two-thirds of the increase in our federal prison system and more than half of the increase in our state prison system between 1985 and 2000, the period of our prison system's most dramatic expansion. Drug convictions have increased more than 1,000% since the drug war began. I mean, to get a sense of how large a contribution the war on drugs has made to mass incarceration, consider this. There are more people in prisons and jails today just for drug offenses than were incarcerated for all reasons in 1980. Here's another myth. The myth that the war on drugs and Get Tough movement was declared in response to the crack epidemic and related violence in ghetto communities.